series of episodes is brought to you by the Field Museum, the Harvard Museum of Comparative Zoology, and the National Science Foundation. Hey, we're here at Harvard's Museum of Comparative Zoology with Dr. Ken Angielczyk.
And I am the Associate Curator of Fossil Mammals at the Field Museum of Natural History.
And we're here today to do some experimenting on some dead animals to learn more about those fossil mammals. It's going to be great. Let's go.
In the episodes that we've been doing so far, we've talked a lot about synapsids, but you might not know what they are. So a synapsid is a member of a group of animals that includes living mammals as their sort of living relatives, but also a number of fossil forms that in some cases look very different. And all of our different kinds of synapsids are characterized by one feature, this opening back here in the back of the skull, just behind the eye socket. That's an area where jaw muscles attach to the skull, and all synapsids have those. So if you compare an animal like this, this is Eothyrus, one of the most primitive synapsids that we know about, to a living mammal, you can see the skull looks very different, but we have that same synapsid temporal opening back here in this skull the way we did in Eothyrus. So this is an animal called Mesitognathus, which is a more derived or a more advanced kind of synapsid. You can see that it has a skull that is much more similar to our living mammal. Synapsids have undergone a massive amount of evolutionary change over the course of their history, and so there's actually very few features other than that that you can point to in all synapsid specimens.
And that's kind of why we're here today, right? So we're going to be looking at some of the changes in the other parts of the skeletons of these animals, and primarily what is it that we're going to be looking at?
Yeah, so we're interested in the evolution of the backbone of synapsids. So living mammals have very distinct vertebral columns or backbones today that have lots of different regions, and they have very specific functions in each of those regions. And if we look at more primitive synapsids, they have a much more uniform backbone or vertebral column. We can only get so much information out of the fossils. We need to look at some living animals that have their soft tissues like muscles attached to the backbone or vertebral column. And what we can do is learn about how the backbone functions in those animals and then go back to our fossils and essentially model how those vertebral columns would have been working when they had all of their soft tissues attached.
So, we're going to the prep lab. We are here in the preparation lab at Harvard's Museum of Comparative Zoology with Dr. Katrina Jones. Katrina, what is it that you do?
Hi, Emily. I'm a researcher here at the museum, and I study the anatomy and evolution of mammals.
And that is what we have in this bag in front of us.
Exactly, yeah. So this is a Fisher cat, and today we're going to be dissecting out its vertebral column so that we can do experiments on it.
But it's not a fish, kind of. It's a derived fish, and it's not a cat. It's like a big ferret.
Yeah, kind of like a giant ferret otter. So the skin was taken off and is gone to be used in our collections, and all of the organs have been taken out, but now we need to remove the head, the limbs, and get down to the vertebral column, which is what we're interested in.
Let's do it. Should I grab this in?
You can grab it and pull it out.
Ooh, oh boy. You can kind of already, if I'm gonna hold this guy up, you can already sort of see, whoops, now it's bleeding on the table.
That the
ribs, the thoracic vertebrae, and all the muscles that attach to them are kind of contained in that area, and then there's nothing here at the lumbar region.
Yeah, so mammals actually have a region that's free of ribs called the lumbar region, and that's different than some of the ancient mammal ancestors that you were looking at earlier, the synapsids, which had ribs pretty much all the way along their trunk.
Yeah, then you can kind of see where like that would have perhaps inhibited a bit of movement or range of motion.
Yeah, definitely. That's one of the factors, but also the individual shape of the vertebrae and how they fit together is really important for determining how much mobility can happen at each joint. And that's what we want to get a handle on today. Okay, so you want to take a, we'll start with a forelimb.
It pooed on me.
Yeah, sure. It probably did poo on you. Yeah. Sorry about that.
That's okay.
That happens. First thing we're going to do is we're going to remove a forelimb. So what we're going to do is cut down the midline along these, this is the pectoral muscles.
Mm-hmm.
So, loosen those up, release that connection.
Well, that's cool. So I can actually see the different muscle that you just
was the pec major that we call it retracted.
Mm-hmm.
Just retracted it. And so now I'm gonna cut through this connective tissue of the neck so that we can remove the connection with forelimb there.
So what is it, you're kind of cutting the fascia between the muscles?
Mm-hmm. So some muscle attaches into bones, to move bones, mm-hmm. but some muscles actually attach to other muscles, and they do that by attaching to these like thick sheets of connective tissue that we call fascia, mm-hmm. and that sort of helps them to move. And it's kind of cool when you think about all the different things that mammals do with their arms, like yeah. bats flying or like, you know,
whales swimming.
Yeah, exactly. Like a brachiating primate swinging through the treetops. Like,
yeah.
There's a lot of different functions.
A lot of Googling, a lot of Facebooking. Mm-hmm.
Exactly. Yeah, so this muscle, serratus ventralis, actually has muscle fibers that insert in each rib, so it kind of looks jagged, and that's where the name comes from.
So it goes all the way from the back to individual ribs.
Mm-hmm. And this is quite cool here. This is what's called the brachial plexus. So this is a really dense web of nerves. So this is how you get nerve impulses in to move the muscles and sensation out. So I'm actually gonna cut through the brachial plexus. Sorry, brachial plexus.
Oh no.
Off you go.
Yeah. Now he can't use his arm.
Yeah.
Very sad. Because he's dead. Mm-hmm. Also that.
Notice how I'm dissecting a lot with my scissors.
Yeah.
It's even though it's called dissect, ideally you just want to split tissues along their natural planes more than actually cutting through tissues.
Hmm. So you're just separating things.
Separating things, yeah.
Ah, this looks nothing like an arm anymore.
Yeah, it's easy to get disoriented once you have it detached from the
trunk. Well, also it's missing its little hand.
Okay, so we're gonna work on this other limb now. Maybe if you wanted to have a go at doing something, I'd love to. This is the pec muscle, which is here, which uh-huh. sort of flexes the arm like this. So what you're gonna do is detach it from the trunk. Start with the scalpel, and then when it starts coming loose, you can actually just get in there with the scissors.
So like that,
mm-hmm.
and then
so
use,
then you
use
can.
The scissors.
I'll take that, and you use the scissors, and if you kind of pull it towards me, and get some tension, and then you sort of.
I'm trying to mimic your technique.
Yeah,
here.
You sort of spread apart to so you feel how the tissues just spread along their natural plane, and then where there's a connection, you just snip.
Like right there. Snip
yeah.
there?
So yeah. So that's where the muscle is actually inserting onto ribs. So we have to cut that.
This guy has an obscenely thick neck.
Yeah, I feel like this is an aggressive, really muscly male that we're...
Like, he was probably getting some stuff done.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Yeah, probably didn't want to mess with him.
No.
Okay, so we're definitely making progress now. What's holding it on down here still is
the serratus muscles. Yeah.
Exactly, and what do we have over here that we saw earlier?
The connective...
The brachial plexus.
Yeah, that one. That's amazing. They are, I mean, you call them cables. They are like cables.
Mm-hmm. It's like data cables.
Data cables.
Communicating information from the brain to the...
If I spend too much time thinking about that, I just have an existential crisis.
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, oh gosh, there are so many things happening in my body right now that I don't even think about. And then I'm cutting them. Oh no.
Oh, there we go.
Okay.
There's actually like a web of muscle that runs all the way over the neck called platysma. And it's what sort of... allows you to open one of the muscles that helps open the jaw. And it's kind of cool because whales have really giant ones all over.
Whales?
Mm-hmm. Helps them to push the water when they gulp feed.
Like baleen whales?
Mm-hmm. People think dinosaurs are cool, but really, mammals are much cooler.
You hear that, guys? You're gonna start some stuff in the comments of this video.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so there's only the serratus is left, so what I'm gonna have you do. We're gonna put it like that. Mm-hmm. You're gonna hold it, and then you're just gonna run your scalpel.
Sure.
And just cut that, and then that's gonna bring the limb off.
Just like that.
There you go, you have a limb.
Another limb. Two of them. Wow.
Okay, should we do a head next?
Yeah.
Lots of very important things connecting the head and the body going on here.
Yeah. I mean, I would hope there were important things connecting the head to the body. Otherwise, it'd be a lot more likely that I could fall off.
Yeah, that'd be bad news. So we're working our way through these layers of muscles, hoping to get to the joint that connects the head and the neck. It's called the Atlantooccipital joint.
There's just one joint?
Mm-hmm.
That attaches the head to the neck?
That attaches the head to the neck, exactly.
What happens if you cut it?
Then your head falls off.
No way.
You'll see it's quite hard to get to. We're still working our way through muscle layers to try and get to it. So it's not something that's going to happen overnight. So
okay.
You don't have to Don't have to lose sleep over it, Emily. The top two vertebrae mammals, the two that are closest to the head, are really, really, really weirdly shaped. So that the one that connects the head to the neck, the atlas, only allows movement like this. And the one beneath it, the axis, only allows movement like this. So it's like the yes joint and the no joint.
And they work
and
together.
And they work together to produce all the other movements that you regulate.
Like a bobblehead.
Mm-hmm.
So you've got a lot of these neck muscles kind of dissected off.
Yep. And we can actually start to feel the joint between the head and the neck. So if you just pinch with your thumb and forefinger right there, I'm going to do a yes action with the head, and that's what you're feeling is the Atlantooccipital joint moving. And so that's what we're going to try and cut through to separate the head off.
I mean, it's probably for the best that it's difficult for your head to be removed.
We're almost through. Just one little bit. Okay, I see. You ready?
Yes! Get it. Here
Yay.
You go. Oh!
So satisfying.
And it lost its head. There we go.
Yeah, so the head and all of the neck muscles.
It's somehow more disturbing with just like the neck muscles as a part of it.
How's it going, Katrina? I'm good, thank you, dead fish ahead.
Okay,
kind of eating fire.
Yeah, here we go. We'll just leave this here.
Okay, I think it's time for you to do the honors. Remove the baculum.
All right.
Since you're wearing the baculum earrings, so you're just gonna cut along this connective tissue here. So
here.
Mm-hmm.
I've never so surgically clipped a penis bone off.
Great, and along that side too.
Wow. I feel a bit...
We can keep this as well, you know. Someone might be interested in studying it one day. You want to cut through the urethra?
Here we go.
There we go.
Keep going?
Yeah, let's just take it all off.
Take it all off.
There we go. Perfect.
All right. Well, just lay that out there.
All done.
The bits. This is just saline solution. We got to keep those muscles hydrated. Hydration's important, even post-mortem.
So this is like the equivalent of like hamstrings in humans.
It's kind of the groin area.
Mm-hmm. So just running the scalpel along the pelvis and cutting all the connections. Okay, and then we'll cut the quads. Okay, so now all that's left connecting is the head of the femur into the acetabulum, which is the...
So that ball and socket joint.
Ball and socket joint. I've just cut into the opening of the joint there.
I can see it,
so
yeah.
So now I'm just cutting the ligaments. Okay. So we've opened up the capsule of the joint that... So
ooh.
This is the head of the femur, and that fits in here into the acetabulum. And see, I put my probe under here. There's like a connection.
Yeah.
That's called the ligament of the head of the femur, and that actually keeps the femur in its socket. So if you want to do the honors, this is going to sort of allow the whole thing to just pop open. If you take the scalpel and cut through the ligament right by where my thing is, and it pops out once that's cut.
That's it. And then the femur is so tiny compared to all of the muscle that's around it. I mean, the bone is just not even as wide as my pinky finger. And then all these other muscles are just coming in. And
yeah,
this is a powerful animal.
Okay, you want to have a try with the other limb?
Sure.
Yep.
I can
feel
the bone.
And then if you wiggle, you can feel... Okay, so you already got to the joint there.
Okay.
So now we're going to open up the joint capsule. So can you want to put your finger and feel where it is?
It's right there.
Yeah, feel it?
Yep.
Great. So then cut where you felt the joint moving.
And you just keep cutting around?
Yeah, so you just cut into the ligament.
There it is. Good. You just don't want to cut your finger right there.
Right. That's good. Thank
you. I did it.
There we go.
And the leg is off.
The leg is off, right?
We'll just put that over there. Make sure we're hydrating those legs.
And so now what we have left is the vertebral column, the pelvis, and the ribs. And so before we do our experiments, we'll also remove the pelvis and we'll remove the ribs. That takes kind of a long time, so we might skip to the next specimen.
Because we already have it like a cooking show already done.
Mm-hmm.
So this is the one that we just dissected.
Mm-hmm. So the next step would be to actually remove the rib cage and to start cleaning off some of these muscles. So these are called apaxial muscles, which means muscles that run on top of the spine. Mm-hmm. So I've started to do that in this smaller fissure that we have from earlier. And one thing that we can see here, which is super cool, notice how that there are really, really long strips of muscle running all the way down the back. Mm-hmm. And this is kind of a neat mammal feature. So if you were to look at the apaxial muscles of, say, reptiles, the muscles would be much shorter. But we have these really long, they call them tracts of muscles.
I see.
So that when the spine wants to flex like this, they can contract and they can form the flexion and extension action that we know is really important when mammals are using their asymmetric gaits like galloping and bounding. So this is sort of before, and then after we remove the ribs and all of the muscles, we end up with something like this. And then notice how flexion extension is happening a lot here. But if we do twisting, there's no twisting happening down here. And that's because the vertebral joints down here lock together and prevent twisting, whereas those up here can move by each other.
They help enable the twisting.
See them twisting.
So do you hypothesize that those early synapsids, like Dimetrodon or Adaphosaurus, that their spine was more like the lumbar here or more like the thoracic? Like, was it more or less flexible?
It was less flexible, mm-hmm. But when you look at the vertebrae, they don't look quite like either thoracic or lumbar. From the shape of the joints, we suspect that they might have been able to do more lateral flexion, but we don't think that they were able to do any of this.
So they kind of bending. Moved back and forth like a lizard.
Mm-hmm, exactly.
And
we hypothesize that the evolution of specialized joints which allow bending, flexion, extension like this might be related to the evolution of asymmetric gaits in mammals. So the division of the vertebral column into regions is controlled by a set of genes called the Hox genes.
So it's like it was the evolution of the genes that enabled the evolution of the morphology of the mm-hmm. spine.
Well, yeah, I mean, it's the genes which evolve. And it's nice here because we have such a direct link. So we can clearly see that where a particular gene is expressed, that's where a particular region forms in the adults. So if we can measure the presence of different regions based off of vertebrae in the fossil record, we can infer the expression of genes in animals that lived millions of years ago.
So you're doing genetic research on animals that are like 200 million years old?
Indirectly, by mapping out how regionalization has changed through time.
That's pretty exciting. That's pretty cool stuff.
Very exciting.
Welcome to the 21st century.
Mm-hmm.
Awesome.
It still has brains on it.